Hello and welcome to the Newspaper Show with me, Mike Mendoza, here at Latest TV. I'm, of course, with Mark Walker, as always. Mark, welcome to you.
You're right.
Albion had a decent draw in Scotland.
Yeah, Rangers, yeah. I mean, it's only friendly, but...
Yeah, I know, but we can win friendlies.
Yeah.
I think we usually lose friendlies, but it's nice to see us draw against the top club in Scotland.
Yeah.
Even though they didn't play any of their players, and we didn't play hardly any of ours either.
No. But we still
got a waste of time, really. It was just a trip, wasn't it? Really?
Yeah.
If nothing else. Olympics, are you watching the Olympics?
Yeah, I am. 3 golds as it stands, but that's going to be more. I think we're going to get another one today, Taekwondo. So, yeah, I think we're going to get quite a few golds. Maybe not the 67 medals we got the last Olympics, but because I know we've had a few disappointments already. But, yeah, we should do quite well. We always do well at the Olympics, don't we?
And Andy Murray's pulled out already.
Yeah.
Didn't take long, does it?
Well, yeah, not only for the singles knocks, so you can't defend that title, unfortunately. So we're not in that one. But, he's sitting in the doubles. We could win the doubles.
Shame, really.
Yeah.
But I must say, I'm thoroughly bored with it already.
Really?
Yeah, I can't be bothered to watch it now.
Right, OK. Terrible,
isn't it? Bring a smile to your face.
Yeah.
OK, let's look at some of the stories. And we're looking, of course, at both inside the papers, outside the papers, locally and nationally. And we're starting off with a local story. This is about residents pleased with scrapping of old Shoreham Road cycle lane. This, of course, has been a bone of contention for a long time, or 18 months or so. Residents living near the controversial cycle lanes are celebrating after the council has voted to progress with its removal. And I think Labour and Conservatives, I think probably for the first time in history, worked together on Brighton Council.
Yeah, they did, and there's this photo here, and my colleague Millie Dobre and I were actually there behind that photo because we were also speaking to the same residents and councillors for that story. And I mean, to be honest, we struggled to find a cyclist to speak to for the story. I know my colleague's editing it at the moment, Millie, but we discovered, you know, we were struggling to find cyclists. It isn't that very well used, and that was for us to see when we were down there the other day. So, I mean, yeah, it makes sense to scrap that cycle lane. I mean, it's a divisive issue in the city, but I think it makes sense. I mean, it's not used. I mean, as I say, we found that out for ourselves yet again the other day. And, you know, maybe it's going to go elsewhere. So either, New Church Road, maybe Portland Road, there's discussions or at least
really?
There's... Yeah, possibly, yeah. Gosh. Yeah.
I think the seafront one is perfect. The A259 is fine. I've got no problem with that at all. It was interesting that the leader, the Green leader, said that although this was a consultation, it wasn't a referendum.
So no.
Therefore, like most consultations, they're ignored.
Yeah.
But, of course, this time it was a victory for the little people. And
yeah, I mean, I think because from the Labour perspective, they got key seats down there in Portslade, haven't they, that they want to hold on to at the next local elections. Labour probably thinking that they can take the council again, given that the Greens are going to suffer politically, no doubt, from this debacle on Old Shoreham Road. So, I mean, I don't know why the Greens just didn't give up that cycle lane earlier. Keep the other cycle lanes. The seafront one is much more widely used. Call it quits on the old cycle, on the Old Shoreham Road cycle lane, and then, you know, they might have been in a better position, but they just wanted to hold on to something that no one really wants. I mean, I know there are some cyclists in favour of it, but most cyclists I've spoken to are actually against that cycle lane and they don't use it because they say it's too dangerous.
So. There are the arguments the Greens are putting forward that Stapley Road, for example, which is a disaster up there where the cycle lane is, and turning left from there, you can only turn left anyway out of Stapley Road into the Old Shoreham Road. There's total confusion there and it's dangerous to pull out. And yet the Greens were saying, oh, it's always been a problem there. Well, you've never had one lane blocked off and have to get across it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's where we were as well the other day talking to the residents. We were around Stapley Road area. So, yeah, that whole... Once the cycle lane's gone, which is going to be in about a month's time, then that whole area needs to be looked at again.
Celebration.
Yeah. Well, I think it is for them, but, I mean, it's long overdue, really, so it should have happened a long time ago, most people would say.
I was involved in the original cycle lane on Hove and Brighton Seafront when I was on the old Hove Council. So that's going back a few years. So we actually, you know, we did put in a cycle lane. We were in favour of it in the right place. I've got no problem with cycle lanes. They're talking now, and we'll be talking about this a bit later on, another cycle lane going into the Upper Shoreham Road.
Yeah.
There was a big demonstration about that the weekend, which we'll talk about. Anyway, let's look at another story. Holidays could be ruined for 6 million Brits if Spain and Greece join France on Amber Plus list, meaning even double jab people will have to quarantine for 10 days.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'm not going away abroad this year, but I know that some people want to travel to Spain, Greece, you know, Italy, France, etc. Not just for a holiday, but to see family as well. So it's not always a holiday. But yeah, it sounds chaotic. I mean, there's no way I'd be flying this year unless I really had to. It just seems completely chaotic. I mean, you know, you've got border agency staff being pinged, so they're not there. It's queues here, there, everywhere, stifling heat. I mean, it doesn't sound like much fun to me. I'd much rather just stay in the UK. And in fact, in Brighton, it's been pretty stunning anyway. We've had kind of Mediterranean-style weather the last few days anyway. So
last year when we first went to the first lockdown, it was unbelievable weather.
Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful weather last year. It's been different this year.
Yeah, it has.
I was in Windsor last week, and again, the weather was absolutely scorching. It was in the 30s then.
Yeah.
But one thing very noticeable, no visitors.
Yeah.
You know, just a few Brits there, and everything closes at 9 now there because they rely on tourism.
Yeah.
I mean, the Japanese, of course, probably their biggest market. Not a single Japanese person
and
there.
And that isn't going to recover this year, is it?
No.
Let's face it. So that's going to be more. I mean, and the numbers are pretty good at the moment. They're going down in the UK. I know we're going to be talking about that. And if that carries on, then hopefully it can open up more of the travel industry. And,
Definitely. So. The next story, which surprises me, because, you know, people are up in arms at the moment, wanting their verges cut. Sadness as road verges mown. This is Worthing Climate Action Network, who don't want the verges mown. They think it's a wonderful idea, get the bees at it and all the butterflies and everyone else playing in their little homeland there. But, you know, this is absolutely a ridiculous idea. It's dangerous, it's ugly. It's like going back to a third world country when you look at some areas around Brighton.
Yeah, I mean, I was around Blatchington Road area yesterday and it's like crazy.
There's trees growing in the middle of the road at the moment.
Yeah, absolutely madness. So, I mean,
this
not
is
sure what
we're
this has
looking
got to
at
do with climate change, to be honest. It's, you know, I mean, I'm looking at this grass verge here. Is that really attracting bees? I mean, maybe I haven't got a good enough picture of it, but, you know, I'm all for taking strong action against climate change, but to me, that's just a whole bunch of weeds with nothing much in it apart from litter.
Very true. But, you know, everybody's up in arms at the moment. I mean, how terrible the roads do look. And they are dangerous.
Yeah.
Some of them, they're so overgrown. And to want to keep it that way. And what surprises me is it's not actually young people.
Yeah.
There's quite a few older people in that photo as well, which is amazing.
Yeah, exactly. So, I'm all for climate change action. And I know they've got a climate emergency over in Worthing, like Brighton and Hove does and Ada as well. But, yeah, I mean, obviously the grass verges need to be cut. Because it's dangerous for a start for people walking. You know, around Brighton, some of these pavements are actually dangerous to walk along.
Yeah, very much so. OK, the next story is about moaners say BBC had bias for Euros. Of course they would. The BBC has been accused of biased coverage of the Euro 2020 and insensitivity towards Emma Raducanu's Wimbledon exit. The broadcaster received 133 complaints of pro-English commentary as the Three Lions played their first major final in 55 years. Come on, the BBC, British Broadcasting Corporation. Of course they're going to be in favour of Britain.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not, no, don't really, I mean, I'm not sure why they would complain. I can't really fathom that one out. But yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, once the other teams in the UK were knocked out, which was fairly early on, then obviously the BBC was going to focus on England being the only UK team in there. So I don't really understand why you would complain. It doesn't make any sense to me.
No, these moaners, they should just shop up, they say. Let's get one more story in before the break. Green light for new bike rental scheme. Again, this is back to Adrian Worthing. Councillors have given the firm thumbs up for the idea of a large-scale bike and electric bike rental scheme in Worthing and Ada. They've already started to develop a map of potential hub locations where people will be able to pick up or drop off one of the 322 bikes. They're also talking about e-scooters. Which at the moment are illegal, of course, to ride, unless it's a part of a rental scheme. And I don't think that Adrian Worthing are part of the government e-rental trial.
Yeah, there is a trial. I'm not sure Brighton are either, are they?
No, they're not.
Sure.
No.
So, I mean, I think e-scooters are probably here to stay. I think they're going to be having to be licensed, I would say.
Yeah.
I can see e-scooters being licensed, but because they are part of the climate change kind of solution in a way, because if you're not driving a car but you're taking an e-scooter, and you can use, I think they should be able to use the cycle paths, which they do. So all these cycle lanes that we have in Brighton, they should be for e-scooters and for cyclists, which I think is where it's going, and skateboarders and all the rest of it. And then if that gets people off of cars using those lanes where they're appropriate, then that makes sense. So.
I mean, it's been successful in Brighton, hasn't it, the hire of bikes in general. But I think this will be the first time we're actually talking about e-bikes as well.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, I mean, I'm all for that. It's good that Ada and Worthing have got it. And maybe you can take that bike into Brighton as well and have a scheme where the bikes from Brighton can be dropped off in Adron Worthing and then vice versa. That would make sense.
Actually, I noticed around Shoreham there's a lot of people do cycle from Brighton along to Shoreham. And I often sit at the end of E Street there having a cup of coffee. And all the time you're seeing the bikes arriving down there. So they go for a nice long ride.
Yeah.
And it's good value. I think it's a great idea, although people would say it was Boris's idea, the Boris bikes in London, but it works. He does come up with some good ideas sometimes.
Yeah.
You may not be in favour of bikes and bike lanes, but this one is certainly a goer, I think.
Yeah.
OK, it's time for a quick break. We've got lots more stories to talk about in the second part. I'm Mike Mendoza, and of course I'm here with Mark Walker here at Latest TV and the Newspaper Show. Back after the break. Don't go away. Well, welcome back to Latest TV's Newspaper Show with me, Mike Mendoza, and of course joined by Mark Walker, as always. Just can't get rid of him. We try, we change the combination on the front door, he still gets in.
Somehow.
I don't know how you do it. Unbelievable.
Yep.
Okay, looking at the stories both inside and outside the newspapers, both nationally and local. And the first story is Harry makes a quick Froxit. It's about Prince Harry. Apparently his Windsor cottage has been cleared.
Yeah, I mean, they didn't want to be in the media. You'd never hear the end of it. They're literally, dominating the media at the moment, which I guess is good for them. It's part of their strategy. But I thought they went to LA to get out of the media. Then they were complaining about media intrusion, and now they're always in the media.
More than ever, isn't it, really?
More than ever, and they seem to be placing these stories in the media as well. Well, their team does, so I don't really get it. I think it's all going to end in tears for them, I have to say. And it ended in tears for them at Frogmore as well, because they've now been booted out of that place and they've had to remove all their possessions. So, it's a bit of a sad story, really.
No, I mean, that was left to him by his grandmother, wasn't it, originally?
Yeah.
By the way, it's interesting to see that also that Meghan Markle's father, Thomas Markle, has threatened to take Meghan and Prince Harry to court so he can see his grandchildren. So the story is just going to roll on there, isn't it, really?
Yeah, it's a mess, really. I do feel a bit sorry for them because I'm not sure they knew what they were getting themselves into. And they just happened to sell their soul, really, to the media in order to make the money to live the kind of lifestyle that they're leading. So it's really sad. It's very sad.
Yeah, OK. Next story, this is a local story. Decision to remove cycle lanes sees county barred from next active travel funding pot. This is about West Sussex County Council, who, of course, removed a lot of their cycle lanes, the pop-up lanes, last year, soon after they were first erected. I mean, they were put in such stupid places, around the centre of Worthing, for example, where you couldn't even get around a roundabout because the cycle lanes were so big.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
Ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous.
Total chaos. I mean, I think that's the government, the UK government's fault in a way, because they were obviously encouraging this active travel, councils to go for this active travel funding pot. So, I mean, it's, as we've seen in Brighton at the Old Shoreham Road, it can lead in tears, in chaos, anger, division. So you've got to really just carefully consider where you're putting cycle lanes, because people aren't against them, but they've just got to be carefully considered and not put in willy-nilly, because it just ends in tears like we've seen in Old Shoreham Road.
Well, this could explain why they've kept them in the Old Shoreham Road, because they'll probably lose their grant if they did take them away earlier. I mean, Brighton Hove, sorry, Adrian Worthing received £780,000 in the first phase. Could have had £2.3 million.
Yeah.
Now they're talking about putting another lane in. This is going to be in the Upper Shoreham Road. Not possibly as bad as they're talking about, because I heard today they're actually going to reduce the size of the cycle lane. But it's going to be a pain, but they're going to have to pay for it, because the government are not going to pay for this one.
No, exactly. I mean, that one seemed crazy that they took it out, then they want to put it back in again. I mean, that's taxpayers' money, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, I mean, if I was that council, I'd just leave that strip alone and focus on another area. Because I actually know the guy, the minister there as well. I knew when I worked in Brussels. So, you know, he's quite a tough cookie, really. So they're not going to release that funding to West Sussex County Council for that area for a cycle lane.
Is this Chris Heaton Harris?
Chris Heaton Harris, I know him, yeah.
Yeah, oh, well done.
Yeah.
Very nice. Hope he knows you. The next one is U-turn on ping policy. Downing Street is forced into another U-turn as it was announced that police, fire crews and some border force staff at ports can skip isolation regardless of vaccine status.
Yeah.
They're forced into this, aren't they?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that just needs to be... I mean, we've got to wait till the 16th, 19th of August, haven't we, for all the rules did change. But obviously, if you've been double jabbed, then you know, you don't need to self-isolate for 10 days in August, we're being told. So, yeah, it's causing total chaos, isn't it? I mean, I just feel sorry for the business owners, don't you, that are being affected by all of this confusion, chaos. I mean, it's just carnage, really. It must be quite stressful times in, like, you know, retail industry, borders, local councils, you name it. It's a sea of chaos for the moment. Hopefully, it'll all change next month, though.
I mean, I had a meeting with the police last week. I wasn't helping them with their inquiries, but it was something else. And they were using the excuse that they have not got the police at the moment because of the pinging. And a lot of people I know have actually taken the app off their phones.
Yeah.
A lot of people have.
Yeah, well, you have to... people I know work for the NHS, you have to switch it off in certain... I don't know what it is. I don't know whether that's an issue to do with, you know, switching your phones off or not, but I know that NHS stuff, people... that me and my wife know, I'm told to turn it off as well, so...
Yeah. And already supermarkets are starting to suffer because people are not being able to go out and deliver. They've been pinged.
Yeah.
Supermarket shelves are empty in many stores at the moment. So it's a bit like the beginning of lockdown when they're all buying toilet paper.
Yeah, exactly.
I've almost run out of my original toilet paper. I must get some more now.
Yeah, you must do, yeah, to get another...
another 5,000 rolls.
Another 5,000 rolls.
OK. Yeah. Good news for Brighton. Theatre Royal Brighton is set to reopen after 16 months in the dark.
Yeah. Yeah, Theatre Royal, I mean, we've been there a lot. My colleague Gail knows it very well. She's done a lot of presenting there. She knows them. We all know Andrew Comben as well, the CEO. So, well, that's Brighton. That's the Brighton Pavilion anyway. Theatre Royal is another one of those attractions which, it's long overdue, isn't it, for that opening up. I can imagine that being quite difficult for COVID because it's quite a tight area. You know, it's an old building, obviously, and it must be quite difficult to have social distancing measures of being there. So I don't know whether they're going to have social distancing measures or anything.
They don't need to now.
They don't need to, do they? So yeah. I know some businesses are, but I'm just thinking of if they're going to have any at all, because I can imagine it being pretty difficult to make that feasible in an old building like the Theatre Royal.
Yeah, I mean, you look at theatres in London where the seating is so tight. I think Lloyd Webber is probably one of the biggest culprits of this, of bringing seating closer together to get more people in there. And it gets very uncomfortable in some theatres, I must say. But hopefully, we're back
to
normal.
It's come back, yeah, so that's good. I mean, year and a half out in the dark, so it's be good for that to come back.
OK, next story. This is by Trevor Kavanagh. Lovely guy, Trevor. I worked with him for a long time, some time ago. Boris has got the job done, but at a cost. And, of course, Boris's popularity went down, I think, quite a bit last weekend.
Yeah.
Labour haven't gone up that much, funny enough, but his has gone down. I think 38%.
Yeah.
So when he stood on the steps of Downing Street as Prime Minister in July 2019, the skies were blue, the streets of Britain were paved with Brexit gold. All he needed to do was break the parliamentary legam and finally get us out of the EU, which he did. You know, he did a good job at doing that. I mean, it was unfortunate. As soon as he was elected, you had floods in the West Country. You had the pandemic. He couldn't have come in at a worse time, could he? Whatever he's going to do, he's going to be criticised.
No, exactly. Yeah, I mean, I mean, obviously the death toll's pretty high in the UK, but I think I'm not sure any other government would have done any differently to what they did. And we'll wait and see what the numbers are on the current easing of pretty much all the restrictions. But at the moment, the data looks quite good, so that could run in their favour if we've got a drop in, and if the vaccination has basically meant that we've got a drop in the number of cases and we didn't need a lockdown, that'd be very significant. We'll wait and see what happens with that, but that would be big news if that happens in the UK over the next few weeks.
So you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. We'll see. And as you said, the cases are going down at the moment, so it's pretty fantastic.
Which is good for everyone, of course.
Tim Lawton, my mate Tim, the MP for East Worthing and Shoreham, he says proposed cycle lane needs to be workable and safe. This is back to the Upper Shoreham Road cycle lane they're talking about. But, you know, you've got to have a proper consultation on this.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I mean, obviously, it's dominating the airwaves at the moment, cycle lanes, when it really shouldn't be. I think, you know, that was the argument about Old Shoreham Road. It was giving cyclists a bad name, really, the Old Shoreham Road cycle lane, particularly when people were cycling on pavement, cyclists, and not using the cycle lane. So the few cyclists that were in that area were using the pavement, not the actual cycle lane. So it got pretty chaotic. So we need to have consensus, which I think... you know, one of our local MPs here, Tim Lawton, is saying that we need a workable and safe cycle lane policy rather than, you know, this kind of chaotic kind of strategy that we had over the pandemic.
What they're trying to do is find a decent way, a proper scheme to link Shoreham Academy with Sir Robert Woodard Academy, which is in Lansing or something.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, at the moment, they've got to go along the A27, which is very dangerous.
Yeah, and that's a much stronger rationale than the one along Old Shoreham Road, where it wasn't. I know that's the main artery between, you know, Shoreham and Brighton, but it was never really going to be suitable for cyclists. That's what no-one really understood. You know, the seafront route is much more feasible, makes more sense.
Yeah. OK, next story. Let's get this one in. It's a national one. 22,000 across the channel this year. You believe that? The border force expects up to 22,000 migrants to cross the channel in boats this year alone, nearly triple the 2020 total. You don't believe this figure, do you?
Yeah, I'm not sure it's going to be that high. I mean, what is it at the moment? Just under 9,000, isn't it? So, obviously, we've got the winter period coming up after September. It depends on what the weather's like, really. I mean, those crossings depend on two things, really, the weather and what the French do over on their side of the border. We're paying them all these millions of pounds all the time to police their borders. So that might have an impact on the smugglers, which is obviously the main target.
Isn't one of Priti Patel's new rules that they're going to send people back straight away rather than house them or help them?
Well, it depends, really. They're going to make it illegal to make the crossing for a start, so that you won't be prioritised for...
So where do you get sent back? If you get prosecuted, what happens to you? A lot of young kids.
Yeah, no idea how that's all going to work out. I think it's going through Parliament at the moment. The Border Force will be able to intercept boats and they'll be able to do... kind of checks and maybe send them back if the French agree, but the French
are not going to agree to anything.
No, exactly, so it's unlikely to happen.
Goodness me, you've never seen the French agree on anything. Anyway, listen, we're out of time, Mark. Thank you so much indeed. Thank you for your company today. We're back again. We've got a month off. We're back at the beginning of September. We're having a bit of a holiday, a little bit of a break for a few weeks, but thank you so much indeed for being here today. Thanks to Mark. Thanks for watching. We'll see you again soon. All the best. Bye for now.
Goodbye.